new psychological study from the National Institute of Mental Health.
Just this morning, along with his longtime psychiatrist.
Circle of depression is growing wider, broader.
15% of women suffer from this disorder.
Over 20 million American
changes that have occurred in the brain.
Abnormalities in the neurotransmitters.
Is that a chemical imbalance?
Well, got a problem. They've got a drug.
6 million American kids take prescribed medication.
Psychiatric care.
But what if the criminal is mentally ill?
The punishment, a form of aversion therapy.
10 in appears on the show, but I want to follow.
Seasonal affective disorder.
Oppositional defiant disorder.
Schools criticized for overprescribing.
Où que vous regardiez, vous la trouvez. Vous ne pensez rien avoir à faire avec la psychiatrie ? Réfléchissez-y. Le monde de la psychiatrie s'est immiscé partout dans votre vie.
They basically believe that everyone is mentally ill.
You smoke too much, it's a disease. You're too unhappy, it's a disease. You're too thin, it's a disease. You're too fat, it's a disease.
Where are these coming from? These are coming from the minds of psychiatrists that are dreaming these things up. Writing papers and getting published with their names on it, calling creating these new diseases.
First he said that I had ADD. Then he said that I was depressed. Then he said I might be bipolar, but I don't have ADD anymore.
And he said, you know, I've been noticing you and I wonder if you have it too.
What they decided is that both my husband and my son had a chemical imbalance that needed to be corrected with a chemical balancer.
There is not one shred of credible evidence that any respectable scientist would consider valid, demonstrating that anything that psychiatrists call mental illness are brain diseases or biochemical imbalances. It's all fraud.
There is no reliability of diagnosis, and there is no science. It's just pseudoscience. It's pretend science.
This is one of the most open secrets in all of America in the psychiatric field, that nothing is being done that's legitimate, and they're billing for it.
Les psychiatres prétendent que plus d'un milliard de personnes sont mentalement malades. Depuis 30 ans, ils ont prescrit des psychotropes à 543 millions de personnes. Actuellement, ils prescrivent des stimulants et des antidépresseurs à 17 millions d'écoliers. Interrogés récemment sur l'aspect scientifique de leur profession, les psychiatres qui ont consenti à être interviewés n'ont donné que des excuses.
Psychiatric illness is not really an illness.
How do you evaluate if someone is cured or sick?
Cure is certainly something we look forward to. We had no earthly idea how to accomplish.
We're not good at causes. We don't know what causes mental illness.
En dépit de cela, il se déclare expert dans le domaine de la santé mentale et continue de traiter des gens contre leur gré. Quels en sont les résultats?
This psychiatrist, man who's supposed to work to heal people, has done nothing but destroy this man's life, and in destroying his life, destroying the lives of all of his loved ones. Excuse me.
They've damaged and ruined my son, and they've trapped him in a system.
The way that they treated him and made him feel like he was worthless.
Ryan was being kept dumb and high on Ritalin so that they could make $2,500 per month.
He gave me Valium, and I got addicted to it.
It wiped out my life.
My life has been ruined. My joy has been stolen.
She was lying there. She took two gasps of air and died right there in front of me.
It is really tragic. It's awful. And it's being done for money. That's why it's being done.
Oh, it's got to be in the billions. I don't know the exact number, but it's got to be in the billions. It's just unbelievable.
This is so big that it boggles the mind.
Considérez cette tragédie humaine et multipliez cela par des millions. Depuis 40 ans, il y a presque deux fois plus de décès dans les hôpitaux psychiatriques américains que dans toutes les guerres américaines depuis 1776. Les compagnies d'assurance versent 69 milliards de dollars par an pour des soins psychiatriques, doublant le coût des primes d'assurance maladie. Et malgré 2 billions de dollars amassés par an, ils n'ont à leur actif aucune guérison. Difficile à croire, c'est exactement ce qu'ils espèrent. Et comme nous allons vous le montrer, c'est de cette façon qu'ils s'en sont tirés à bon compte depuis le début.
Roots of psychiatry have to do with control, power, and alienation from certain groups of people who were uncomfortable to be around. They were locked up in these places to get them out of the way. The history of psychiatry, I think, really is related to institutions.
L'Hôpital Royal de Bethléem à Londres fut l'un des premiers centres psychiatriques au monde. Surnommé Bedlam, l'hôpital n'était guère mieux qu'un entrepôt pour ceux considérés comme fous. Les internés étaient confinés dans des cages, des placards et des stalles, enchaînés aux murs et flagellés. Et l'asile, moyennant de l'argent, accueillait le public pour voir le spectacle. Au XVIIIe siècle, William Batty fut le premier à répandre l'idée que ces asiles pouvaient guérir les malades mentaux. Les maisons de fous de Batty ont fait de lui l'un des hommes les plus riches d'Angleterre, bien que ses traitements aient été tout aussi inhumains que ceux de Bedlam et qu'aucun patient n'ait été guéri. Son succès financier déclencha un boom commercial et une occasion pour les psychiatres de tirer profit de cette industrie florissante.
This was an era where, on both sides of the Atlantic, specialized institutions for the mentally ill are beginning to be built in large numbers. Those institutions date back certainly to the beginning of the 18th century and in a few cases even earlier than that. But the explosive growth of an asylum sector, of asylumdom, as some historians have called it, is very much a 19th century phenomenon. It's that period when the state is persuaded to invest tax dollars in building these places.
Mais tandis que les directeurs des institutions s'enrichissaient, les psychiatres n'avaient pas encore suffisamment de crédibilité pour maximiser leurs profits.
In order to justify their profession, they needed to come up with these biological solutions, or they didn't have any profession. The only way for them to solve that was to attempt to start believing that these people that were suffering from emotional disorders was from a biological basis. Whatever was done to make this person more manageable would be simply called a treatment. And the sad reality is that many of these so-called treatments were, in essence, torture.
The near-drowning devices that were developed in this period, for example, must have been appallingly frightening. For example, one device involved putting the patient into a coffin, closing the lid, and dumping it into a bath of water, and then opening it up and trying to revive the patient. There were a range of these things, and the mortality rate was very, very high.
Par la suite, les psychiatres ont cherché à rendre leur pratique crédible en l'affublant d'un langage médical. Ce remodelage du traitement a pris le nom de modèle médical.
Somebody who's really hyper and manic, if you're wrapped up in a cold sheet and dunked into some water, you're going to quit acting manic because that's a punishing treatment. So, but as soon as the symptoms started to go away, they started to believe that somehow by wrapping them up and dunking them in cold water, it was draining the toxics out of their body. So they built the medical model around that.
Mettant en avant la théorie biologique de la maladie mentale, l'Américain Benjamin Rush promut l'idée que la folie était causée par un excès de sang dans la tête. Le traitement, réduire l'afflux de sang par tous les moyens possibles. L'immobilisation, l'eau froide, les saignées, même la terreur. C'est ainsi qu'un nouveau modèle médical fut créé.
Benjamin Rush was probably the most famous American physician of the Revolutionary era. Rush was known as the master bleeder. He bled his patients for madness. He also invented something called the tranquilizer. It's a chair that looks a little bit like an electric chair. The patient was confined in this apparatus sometimes with cold water applied to his or her head, for some hours at a time. And Rush announces in a letter that he's invented this new contraption and dubbed it the tranquilizer.
Les méthodes souvent mortelles de Rush ont été détaillées dans un manuel de 1812 qui a fait autorité durant les 70 années qui ont suivi. Rush était tellement vénéré qu'en 1965, il devint le père de la psychiatrie américaine, son effigie figurant sur le sceau de l'Association psychiatrique américaine. À la fin des années 1800, comme les psychiatres ne pouvaient pas soigner la folie et comme ils sentaient leurs revenus menacés, ils ont inventé de nouveaux modèles médicaux.
The cures promised when was delivered. So by the 1860s and 70s, a growing mood of pessimism was covering Europe and North America, that effectively the new institutions were ever growing in size but not growing in their effectiveness.
Le 20e siècle a apporté davantage de modèles médicaux. Le psychiatre américain Henry Cotton mutilait ses patients, leur ôtant des parties du corps en déclarant qu'il s'agissait d'une percée dans le traitement des maladies mentales.
The earliest target was the teeth and then the tonsils and the sinuses. But when patients didn't get better, the enthusiasts for this treatment then started to move down the body and to say, well, obviously patients have swallowed bacteria in their saliva, so stomachs need to go, spleens need to go, colons need to go.
Cependant, comme l'indignation du public allait grandissant en raison de ces tortures et de ces mutilations, les psychiatres se sont mis à inventer de nouvelles méthodes, chacune annoncée comme un traitement miracle, mais ne s'avérant ni plus efficace ni moins brutale que la dernière.
This is a history of psychiatry, more or less, to damage the patient. I mean, this is a version of the original model, which was to chain them like animals.
If you're doing it to somebody because you insist that they have to change, and you're going to do that by turning the screws, you might say, whether it's with medication, restraint, whatever, that's torture. And a huge part of what psychiatry has done really comes down to torture.
Tout au long du 20e siècle, la psychiatrie a cherché à prouver sa légitimité en prenant l'aspect d'une spécialité médicale. Mais ils ont uniquement réussi à développer des méthodes plus efficaces pour infliger des tortures physiques et mentales, parfois jusqu'à la mort. Un héritage qui se poursuit de nos jours sous la forme très lucrative de prescriptions à grande échelle de psychotropes à des millions de gens. Mais pour ce faire, les psychiatres devaient démolir l'une des croyances les plus chères de l'homme, en déclarant que les gens n'étaient pas ce qu'ils pensaient être. Université de Leipzig, Allemagne, 1879. Le professeur Wilhelm Wundt expérimente les perceptions humaines. Wundt affirme que les pensées, la personnalité et le comportement de l'homme ne sont que des réactions chimiques dans le cerveau.
Wundt became frustrated with his inability to change behavior because he was dealing with the original, you know, psychology, that's the psyche, that's the soul. He created a new science, which was based on man being an animal without a soul, to be trained. Not to be a thinker, but to be trained.
Des étudiants venus du monde entier étudièrent Wundt et sa nouvelle définition de l'homme, soit un organisme sans âme. L'état d'esprit qui régnait à cette époque fut résumé par le philosophe allemand Friedrich Nietzsche.
Gott ist tot. Gott bleibt tot. Wir haben ihn umgebracht.
Le russe Ivan Pavlov, s'appuyant sur les théories de Wundt, expérimenta sur les animaux pour découvrir comment modifier le comportement.
Pavlov studied in Wilhelm Wundt's laboratory in Leipzig, Germany, in the late 1800s. And he experimented with dogs, you know, with electrodes and stimulus response, denying privileges to denying rewards.
And he noticed that when you brought out some food in front of animals, dogs in particular, that they would begin to salivate. So he'd ring the bell at the same time that he brought the food out, and then eventually, instead of bringing the food out, he just rang the bell, and of course the dogs got all excited. He called that a conditioned reflex.
Les premiers cobayes humains de Pavlov étaient des enfants. Il leur perçait des trous dans les joues pour recueillir et mesurer leur salive.
Pavlovian conditioning became one of the major foundations of a lot of behavioral science research in the 20th century.
L'idée selon laquelle le comportement pouvait être contrôlé par un conditionnement répétitif prit le nom de behaviorisme.
The behaviorists believe that all children are animals and can be trained as animals. This was the view of behaviorists. As a matter of fact, John Watson, the most famous of the behaviorists, says that you have to treat human beings or look at human beings the way you would look at the ox you slaughter. See, the behavior is not interested in what's up in your head or your soul because they don't believe there is a soul.
Le successeur de Watson, le psychologue B.F. Skinner de Harvard, pensait que le comportement pouvait être manipulé pour atteindre le but recherché par le psychologue behavioriste.
Skinner developed what's called operant conditioning, where he was able to demonstrate you can change animal behavior by certain schedules of reinforcement, by giving them rewards at certain times, and then you can teach pigeons to play ping pong, for example, and you can teach rats to run mazes, and you can teach human beings to seek certain economic or societal rewards.
Skinner could actually shape new behavior patterns, and this actually was the sort of thing he quite soon became very famous for.
Son expérience la plus notoire a sans doute été la boîte de Skinner.
He was designing a Skinner box, which is something like a big playpen, but everything in it's controlled. The temperature's controlled, the light's controlled, and so on. And the idea is then you present children with certain stimuli that you want them to learn to react to.
Pendant près d'un an, Skinner isola sa fille dans une boîte semblable à celle construite pour des rats.
The child was stimulated and had to respond in a certain way, like a chicken or a rat in a cage, because they firmly believe that children are animals. If you believe, though, that a child is a human being, you can't train him like a rat.
Aujourd'hui, 40 millions de dollars provenant de la poche du contribuable sont versés chaque année par l'Institut de santé mentale pour la recherche du comportement en psychologie. Un total de 19 milliards depuis 1948. Avec ces fonds, les psychiatres utilisent les mêmes méthodes de conditionnement que Pavlov, Watson et Skinner. Exemple, une maison de correction où des enfants sont connectés à des batteries de 270 volts et soumis à des secousses électriques selon une procédure appelée thérapie par aversion.
Antoine was having a number of problems because he was up at a center that was shocking him every time he did anything. There was a button on a little, almost like a TV remote, that would be used and pushed.
They will get an additional shock for trying to remove the electrode. So they're expected to sit there and let this electricity pass through their skin without trying to remove it. If they yell in anticipation of the shock, they will shock the student an additional time for yell.
The cost to send a student to Judge Rottenberg from New York is about $214,000 per student. These students are tortured. They're given this electric shock therapy for no other reason but to inflict pain.
D'autres techniques comprennent le traitement par électrochoc pour perversion sexuelle, l'administration d'impulsions magnétiques dans le crâne pour interrompre l'activité du cerveau, ou encore l'implantation chirurgicale d'électrodes pour réprimer les troubles du comportement. Procédé coûtant jusqu'à 100 000 dollars par patient. Alors que cette science sans âme, pourvoyeuse de techniques de modification du comportement, continue de générer des milliards pour la recherche et le traitement, elle a fourni les bases d'un mouvement psychiatrique responsable de millions de morts.
January 1945, as World War II comes to a close, the full horror of Hitler's final solution is exposed. With grotesque killing factories, unparalleled in human history, Mass graves filled with corpses of men, women, and children murdered by starvation, bullets, and poison gas. What could drive men to commit such atrocities against their fellow human beings?
La réponse se trouve dans une pseudo-science appelée eugénisme, développée et encouragée par la psychiatrie quelques dizaines d'années avant les nazis.
The eugenics movement got started in 1883 with Francis Galton, and he felt that human beings should take evolution in their own hands, and that the most talented individuals, the most healthy individuals, the most attractive individuals should have more offspring.
There was great concern that people that they considered had poor genes were reproducing faster than the people they considered had good genes.
They felt that a medical solution might be the proper one. This is what led to the sterilization movement.
It resulted in sterilization of mentally ill people, sterilization of retarded people, sterilization of people we don't like politically and sociologically. So the problem is not with genetics. The problem is a pretend phony genetics used to justify inhumane social policies.
Au début du XXe siècle, bien que n'étant qu'une théorie sans preuve, l'eugénisme s'était répandu dans près de 30 pays, tels que l'Angleterre, le Brésil, le Mexique, la Suède, la Russie et surtout aux États-Unis, où la stérilisation forcée était alors très courante.
The eugenics movement in Germany was somewhat different than the eugenics movement in the United States in that there were many more physicians and psychiatrists. Alfred Plutch is one of the pioneers in the German eugenics movement and how to control the population of those whom he considered inferior. In 1905, along with his brother-in-law, Ernst Rudin, he established the first organization for racial hygiene.
Alle Nationen haben sich mit einer außergewöhnlich großen Menge an minderwertigen, schwachen, kranken und verkrüppelten abzugeben. Durch kluge Gesetze über Sterilisation würden wir auch in der Lage sein, den vernünftigsten Weg der Zeugung herbeizuführen.
Hitler était particulièrement impressionné par l'eugéniste américain Madison Grant. L'ouvrage de Grant, La disparition de la grande race, fut proclamé par Hitler comme sa Bible privée. Dans son livre Mein Kampf, Hitler saluait l'eugénisme comme la science qui rebâtirait la nation allemande.
Dem ist es nicht erlaubt, seine Krankheit an seine Kinder weiterzugeben. Das Recht auf persönliche Freiheit wird durch seine Pflicht, die Rasse zu beschützen, eingeschränkt.
The German eugenicists welcomed the Nazi advent to power because the Nazi program could fund the very programs that they had in mind. The Nazis gave them political support, financial support, and conversely, the psychiatrists gave the Nazis a medical justification for their genocidal policies.
Something like 40% of German psychiatrists had joined the SS by 1933. They weren't forced into the SS, they just joined it naturally, because the beliefs were very, very similar.
Rudin and his work led directly to the decision to move from sterilization to murder.
Leur plan était simple. D'abord, convaincre le public que les faibles d'esprit voulaient se débarrasser du fardeau de leur existence, mais qu'ils n'arrivaient pas à l'exprimer. Et qu'en les tuant, on faisait preuve de compassion. Puis il s'agissait d'élargir la définition d'inférieur pour y inclure les témoins de Jéhovah, juifs, gitans, homosexuels, nul ne méritant de vivre. Les psychiatres propagèrent l'idée avec des films de massacres nazis, les projetant dans 5300 cinémas allemands.
Geisteskrankheit ist als ein Erbübel eine der größten Gefahren für die Volksgesundheit. Irrtum ist, dass sich solche Kranken glücklich fühlen und am Leben hängen. Sie haben überhaupt kein Daseinsbewusstsein. Wer von ihr befallen wird, dem ist die schwerste Last des Schicksals auferlegt. Ein Dasein ohne Leben.
It first started with passive violence, which is starvation.
It then intensified to lethal injections, and finally it developed into systematic gassing and cremation.
Leurs quartiers généraux étaient établis à Berlin, sous le code infâme de T4.
T4 program was named after Tiergarten 4, which essentially resulted over a period of time in the murder of about 70,000 people who were deemed mentally retarded, emotionally distraught, or physically handicapped by the Germans. They were called life unworthy of living.
Les massacres furent testés dans des centres psychiatriques allemands, puis s'étendirent aux camps de concentration, avec pour bourreau l'élite des psychiatres allemands. Paul Nitsch, le directeur du T4, a déclaré:
Das Aussortieren in den Konzentrationslagern lief etwa genauso ab wie in den Nervenheilanstalten. Und mit selbigen Erfassungsbögen.
6 million Jews died in concentration camps and as a result of Nazi extermination policies. Rudin congratulated Hitler for making his, that is Rudin's, 30-year dream come true.
Après la capitulation des nazis, une cour de justice internationale fut créée afin de juger la psychiatrie pour ses crimes de guerre. Mais les psychiatres américains, craignant qu'un coup définitif ne soit porté au futur de la psychiatrie, sont intervenus, ne jetant le blâme que sur une poignée de psychiatres allemands.
There were some doctors who were prosecuted, but very few. Ernst Rudin returned to Switzerland at the end of the war. He did not serve any prison time.
One of the strangest things of all about the legacy of Nazi science is that some of the nastiest psychiatric eugenicists at the end of the war went back to work either in Germany or sometimes in the United States.
Le projet psychiatrique de départ pour éliminer des humains jugés indésirables s'est vu propager dans le monde civilisé. Responsable du massacre de 11 millions de personnes. Les psychiatres n'ont jamais été traduits en justice et ont continué à répandre le culte de l'eugénisme à travers le monde. De nos jours, nous en voyons les conséquences. Racisme, misère humaine et conflits sociaux interminables.
After World War II, a new eugenics was resurrected out of the bones and ashes of the old eugenics. The eugenics movement has been at the forefront to establish a new scientific racism that justifies oppression and exploitation and racism.
En fait, le racisme fait partie intégrante des origines de la psychiatrie.
The entire history of psychiatry, beginning with scientific conclusions that were made in the 1830s, was an effort to prove the intellectual inferiority of African Americans.
Benjamin Rush is the father of modern psychiatry, and he is the one that gave us the term nigritude. He said that all blacks have inherited this disease, and this particular disease, it caused them to be inferior. In addition to that, it was the reason why it was very important that blacks remain segregated and separate from whites so that whites did not inherit this disease.
Affirmant que la négritude était une forme de lèpre, Rush justifiait la ségrégation comme étant une nécessité médicale. Et cela devint l'argument pour maintenir l'esclavage.
The fact that you have brutalized a whole group of people had nothing to do with that. It had everything to do with some genetic link and that basically you are just a diseased person, so when a slave master wanted to get rid of a recalcitrant slave, they could just say, oh, well, they're suffering from this disease.
Dreptomania, that is the name of the mental disorder that was contrived by Samuel Cartwright, who said that blacks have a mental disorder if they had a desire to run away from slavery.
Running away became such a common problem that psychiatrists attempted to give that a disease. He says, but that's a cure for that. And the answer, the question was, well, what's the cure for that? Frequent whippings. You'd be surprised how that disease clears up when the lash is put in place of their excuses.
Après l'abolition de l'esclavage, le racisme psychiatrique a continué et s'est intensifié. Le journal américain psychiatrique proclamait que les nègres, en tant que descendants de sauvages et de cannibales, n'étaient pas faits pour une civilisation plus avancée. C'est ainsi que leur pseudo-science, l'eugénisme, intensifia le racisme.
There is a clear and long and intimate connection between the eugenics movement and the Ku Klux Klan. Harry Lachlan, who was the Carnegie Institution's director of the Eugenics Record Office, had close relationship to the Ku Klux Klan through the publication of a book called White America, which was written by a major Klan leader. So Lachlan wrote a glowing review of the book in the Eugenics News. And at the same time, you have the Ku Klux Klan using eugenics to justify their racist goals.
Mais le racisme psychiatrique n'existait pas qu'en Amérique. Certains des pires abus du XXe siècle se sont produits en Afrique du Sud, là où le gouvernement adopta les mêmes théories et méthodes racistes qu'Hitler. Ce n'était pas un hasard. Le Premier ministre avait étudié l'eugénisme dans ses études en Allemagne, sous l'influence des nazis dans les années 20.
Dr. Hendrik Verwoerd is regarded as the architect of apartheid. He saw South Africa as a divided state with whites, blacks and brown people living in totally separate areas with black people having no rights whatsoever.
L'apartheid fut l'occasion pour les psychiatres d'ouvrir des hôpitaux psychiatriques partout dans le pays qui n'étaient en fait que des camps de travaux forcés.
These places operated under a private company by the name of Smith Mitchell and Company. They were saving money through the cheap accommodation for psychiatric patients while making massive fortune out of money that Parliament had appropriated for medication. So it was a corrupt system.
Lorsque cette exploitation fut enfin dénoncée, on découvrit que 67 000 prisonniers avaient péri, tandis que le psychiatre avait perçu 117 millions de dollars de la part du gouvernement sud-africain. L'Organisation mondiale de la santé publia un rapport disant que la psychiatrie cultivait le racisme et que l'apartheid était comparable à la propriété et au commerce d'esclaves. En 1971, aux États-Unis, le psychiatre Jolly West perpétua le racisme psychiatrique en manigançant secrètement la thérapie par aversion appelée « Centre contre la violence ». Son projet, financé par l'État, implantait des électrodes dans le cerveau des mâles afro-américains et hispaniques quand ils se montraient violents. Si cela ne fonctionnait pas, il les castrait chimiquement avec des drogues. Quand cette proposition raciste se heurta à l'indignation du public, le projet fut vite enterré. Malgré la diminution des théories racistes implacables de la psychiatrie, elle n'était pas éliminée. En 1994, le psychologue Richard Ernstein, co-auteur du livre « The Bell Curve », prétendait prouver que les Noirs étaient génétiquement inaptes et de ce fait inférieurs aux Blancs.
« The Bell Curve » really argues a very old eugenics idea. It argues that people are born with different kinds of intellectual abilities, that these are inborn pretty much at birth. It goes back to the notion that somehow black people are genetically and biologically inferior to white people as a way to justify what was really its programs of social racism and social sexism. And you see that kind of thinking going on in public school testing and IQ testing and educational testing and tracking.
And this new tool fit into that old mold. It was a new tool that could prove the intellectual inferiority of African Americans.
Psychiatric profession has done great damage, certainly in the past, and far too many in the present too, to subvert democracy and perpetuate racial stereotypes, even more deep racism in society.
We have to battle against this continual misinformation, disinformation, pseudoscience. It can be repackaged in whatever form or format it is, but if it is based solely upon the color of one's skin and then is the merit of that human being, I just reject.
De nos jours, la flamme de la haine continue de brûler, entretenue par des mensonges pseudo-scientifiques. Voilà l'héritage de la psychiatrie, pour justifier le racisme et servir de prétexte à une répression politique.
жить верными коммунистическим идеалам, убежденно, с революционной настойчивостью, притворять в жизнь Ленинский завет, учиться коммунизму, трудиться самоотверженно, по-коммунистически, всей жизнью своей, утверждать на земле дело Ленина, дело партии. Клянемся!
Клянемся! Клянемся! Клянемся!
Le régime soviétique exigeait une loyauté absolue. Ceux qui n'étaient pas dans la ligne du parti étaient considérés dissidents et étiquetés comme ennemis de l'État. Rien qu'un mot à la police secrète et ils disparaissaient dans l'un des hôpitaux psychiatriques spécialisés. En dépit des dangers, ces soi-disant dissidents cherchaient à concrétiser leur idée de liberté.
Я вел жизнь тайную, конспиративную. Никто не знал, что я это делаю. У меня была маленькая подпольная типография. И я стал делать листовки.
Tandis que d'autres se comportaient en citoyens soviétiques loyaux.
Я, например, считал, уверенно считал, что я один из лучших советских людей. Когда уже даже меня арестовали, и написали особо опасный государственный преступник, я рассмеялся. Я при нем, при этом же самом нынешнем генерале, рассмеялся. А он меня вызывает психиатра на утро.
Selon les psychiatres soviétiques, ils souffraient tous de rigidité de conviction. Symptôme d'un nouveau trouble, la schizophrénie stagnante.
Вот когда допьешь все, тогда я заем.
Так, до конца пей.
Берите, я буду с ним. Ребята, ну заставьте его.
Давай пьем.
Comme leurs homologues des autres pays, les psychiatres soviétiques prescrivaient des psychotropes pour guérir leurs patients.
Они никогда их с удовольствием не принимали. И находят пути их не принимать. Мы обязаны просмотреть прием лекарств, чтобы больные лекарства дошли до больного. Вот они где-то уже, как говорится, в горле проглатывают, все, ротовая полость чистая. И потом такие делают какие-то движения, отрыгивают.
Врач на обходе говорит, как себя чувствуете, Петр Петрович? Я говорю, послушайте, вот когда 5 кубиков галоперидола, туда, например, слюна до полу, там перекошенность вся, значит, одни мышцы растягиваются, другие сокращаются. Совершенно ужасные позы, лицо все ужасное. На душе страшно просто. Я человека, вот самое главное, описать это состояние невозможно.
Санитары совершенно безнаказанно могли избивать. По любому поводу. Или вообще без повода. Вот, например, санитар открывает дверь. Тут ты оказался, например, в проеме двери. И вот этого достаточно было, чтобы, скажем, получить удар. Если больной, скажем, оказывал сопротивление при избиении, то его могли привязать и привязывали, и уже избивали, и продолжали избивать уже привязанного.
Проходит, допустим, год, два, там, выписывает убийц, выписывает насильников. Михаил, ты бы лучше убил бы кого-нибудь, мне бы легче было тебя отсюда вытолкнуть. Это было, вот, рождало такое чувство безысходности.
De 1967 à 1987, le gouvernement soviétique arrêta plus de 2 millions de gens. Déclarés malades pour raisons politiques et les soumettant à un traitement psychiatrique. Encore de nos jours, la psychiatrie reste l'outil coercitif préféré des gouvernements dans le monde.
What we learned is that in Gitmo or Guantanamo Bay, that we had teams of healthcare professionals called the biscuit teams, behavioral scientists, psychologists, working with the military to advise them on how far you could push a prisoner. There are abuses that have been documented around the world. We have healthcare professionals who have committed potentially acts of treason within their medical ethics. And there's nobody supervising that. There's nobody making them stand accountable to their medical ethics.
Mais les psychiatres n'ont jamais réservé la torture physique et mentale uniquement aux prisonniers politiques. Tout au long de l'histoire, ils l'ont déguisé et vendu au public comme thérapie. Au début des années 20, les psychiatres ont adopté de nouvelles méthodes censées jouer leur rôle en causant des lésions intentionnelles au cerveau.
Manfred Sokal had this notion that he could kill just the bad brain cells, that somehow we have good brain cells, we have bad brain cells. So if you give people enough insulin, you kill those bad brain cells, and if the person survived this epilepsy, they would be better off for it.
Malgré les convulsions, qui entraînaient de sérieuses lésions de la colonne vertébrale chez 40% des patients, Sokal indiqua que leur comportement enfantin prouvait le succès du traitement. Les hôpitaux s'équipèrent et le coma insulinique devint une affaire lucrative. Le Hongrois Ladislaus van Meduna pensait pouvoir éliminer la maladie mentale par l'injection de métrazole, une substance causant des crises épileptiques et des lésions cérébrales.
He noticed his epileptics had no mental health problems, and his mental health patients, psychiatric patients, seemed to have no epilepsy, and so he thought doing one would obviate the other.
The theory was that epilepsy and schizophrenia couldn't coexist in the same brain, and that if epilepsy was induced, that a seizure was caused, it would, quote, drive out the schizophrenia. There's no scientific basis for this whatsoever.
Le métrazole agissait rapidement et était très lucratif. En une matinée, un seul psychiatre pouvait administrer un traitement de choc chimique à une cinquantaine de patients pour les rendre dociles. En 1939, le métrazole était si populaire chez les psychiatres qu'il était utilisé dans 70% des hôpitaux américains et dans la plupart des pays du monde. La rentabilité de l'insuline et du métrazole entraîna le développement d'une méthode encore plus rentable pour induire des convulsions endommageant le cerveau.
How is electric shock therapy done?
We use these electrodes. We place them on the patient's head like this. And then by means of this machine, we pass a controlled electric current through the brain, just for a fraction of a second. The patient doesn't feel it.
L'histoire de ce remède miracle débuta dans un abattoir à Rome.
In Italy, in 1938, two Italian psychiatrists decided to observe that before slaughtering pigs, in order to make the pigs more docile, they would apply electrodes to their temples that were hooked up to wall current, and that this stunned the pigs, but it didn't kill them, and they could then slaughter them. Well, this gave them the encouragement to try inducing convulsions with electricity.
We would see teeth falling out, broken spines, bones knocked out of joint, broken bones, and people even getting internal organ damage from being restrained while they were having these uncontrolled writhing seizures, convulsions.
Many patients have been returned to their homes and jobs who might still be here if it were not for this helpful form of treatment.
Ayant fait accepter les lésions au cerveau en guise de traitement, les psychiatres visèrent d'autres moyens de s'attaquer au cerveau. La solution leur a été offerte en 1848, lorsqu'une explosion a projeté une barre de fer à travers la tête de Phineas Gage, un cheminot du Vermont. Gage a survécu, mais sa personnalité en a été profondément modifiée. 70 ans plus tard, le neurologue portugais Egas Moniz essaya d'obtenir un résultat similaire en perçant le crâne d'un patient et en injectant de l'alcool pur directement dans le cerveau, détruisant les tissus des lobes frontaux. Moniz appela cette nouvelle procédure une lobotomie. Le docteur Walter G. Freeman allait devenir le praticien le plus infâme de la lobotomie. Il avait découvert un moyen plus rapide de la pratiquer sans avoir à percer le crâne.
There was no anesthesia. And he would just lift up the eye and stick nothing more than an ice pick right into the brain, right under the orbital bone. And then just rake the thing back and forth until he was satisfied that he had caused enough disruption of brain tissue, and then pull it out.
Le docteur Freeman parcourut les États-Unis dans sa lobotomobile, taillant le cerveau de ses patients en public ou parfois dans son véhicule.
And he would pull up and offer lobotomies to people, get referrals from the local doctors, or sometimes people didn't even go through doctors, they'd go right to the lobotomobile, and he would just do the brain damaging procedure right there.
Lorsque sa licence de chirurgien lui fut retirée après la mort de son dernier patient sur la table d'opération, le docteur Freeman avait pratiqué ou supervisé plus de 3500 lobotomies, dont plus de 25%, comme il l'a reconnu, avaient laissé ses patients dans un état végétatif.
They lobotomized a million people in the 40s and the 50s and beginning of the 60s until they came to the conclusion that this was a destructive treatment.
Bien que ces histoires de guérison miraculeuse furent vite dénoncées comme charlatanisme, les psychiatres inventèrent de nouvelles formes de psychochirurgie comme étant des soi-disant avancées médicales.
I completely shuddered from head to toe. And that's what I heard in my head. When he drilled something in my brain.
Northwest, actually, of the center home.
Sorry, I had to do that.
Yeah, why did you have to do that?
My head all shook inside.
Oh dear.
Oh, my head shook inside.
Yes, all right.
Everything shook, the eyes, everything, the teeth.
That's well.
That was grievous bodily harm done to my brain. Mm-hmm. And nobody has the right anyway to play God with somebody's brain.
The whole operation took about 8.5 hours. And they kept me awake for every second of it. And I remember every second of it. And I still remember it to this day because I have this operation every day of my life. Whether I like it or not, I have it.
Les psychiatres vendent toujours les bienfaits de la lobotomie, leur rapportant 31 millions de dollars par an. Mais lorsque la réputation de la lobotomie commença à se ternir, les psychiatres remirent vite l'électrochoc sous les projecteurs. Ils l'ont renommé l'électroconvulsivothérapie et administrent des anesthésiants pour étouffer les hurlements et des agents paralysants pour éviter de voir les contorsions de douleur des patients.
The main misconception that people have about ECT is that it's new and improved. The new and improved refers strictly to these cosmetic improvements because, in fact, they make it easier on the witnesses. The person isn't shaking all over the table. They're paralyzed now. It isn't new, it isn't improved, it is worse.
Every 10 years or so, there tends to be, first of all, a denial that it causes any harm. Secondly, an acknowledgement that it might have caused harm, but here's a whole new approach, and now this one is blameless, without any research to back it up.
The ECT machine can produce anywhere from 50 to 400 volts. It's the kind of energy that we use for industrial machinery that might be in a steel mill or a printing press, some large piece of machinery. It's an extraordinary amount of energy and it causes a great deal of damage.
Si les histoires de prisonniers maltraités par des électrochocs sont largement divulguées, le voltage utilisé par les psychiatres pour donner des électrochocs peut être 33 fois plus élevé. Ces mauvais traitements sont le plus souvent donnés aux plus vulnérables. Les deux tiers des personnes soumises aux électrochocs sont des femmes, chez qui on a diagnostiqué un syndrome prémenstruel, des troubles de la ménopause ou une dépression postpartum. La moitié des patients soumis aux électrochocs sont des personnes âgées. Aux USA, 3,6 fois plus de personnes reçoivent des électrochocs après l'âge de 65 ans, âge qui donne droit à la sécurité sociale. Quelles en sont les conséquences? 40 000 morts et un nombre incalculable de gens avec des lésions au cerveau et sans espoir d'une vie normale. Pour un coût d'électricité de $12, les psychiatres ramassent rien qu'aux États-Unis 5 milliards de dollars. Mais le prochain remède miracle qu'ils ajoutèrent à leur arsenal rapporta plus que jamais du fait que c'était plus rapide, meilleur marché et que ça pouvait faire de chaque homme, femme et enfant un patient à vie. Au début des années 50, les psychiatres ont découvert leur prochain remède miracle. Une substance chimique conçue à l'origine pour tuer les parasites des porcs. Leur nouvelle découverte entravait les fonctions du cerveau, tout comme le ferait un pic à glace introduit dans l'orbite oculaire. Ce n'était qu'un ancien traitement présenté comme nouveau.
With the advent of these new tranquilizing drugs, it seems not too much to say that we're on the verge of an entirely new era in the treatment of mental illness.
La baptisant lobotomie chimique, le psychiatre canadien Heinz Lehmann a décrit la thorazine comme une pilule facile à prendre et ayant les mêmes effets que la psychochirurgie, tout en étant bien plus propre.
Thorazine provided psychiatry with the entry into mainstream medicine. It had its magic bullet. If I'm a psychiatrist and I have to spend an hour talking to someone in psychotherapy, there's only so much I can charge for that hour. But if I can come in, give you a pill, and send you back out in 15 minutes or 10 minutes, that's a much more efficient use of my time monetarily.
Ce que les psychiatres ne disaient pas, c'est que la thorazine causait une dégénérescence nerveuse connue sous le nom de dyskinésie tardive.
And that's a neurological syndrome where you have muscle twitches, abnormal jerks, which are uncontrolled, and they either last for a long time or sometimes they're permanent. So that's very clear, very well recognized, long-term or permanent brain damage from these medications.
Mr. Blount has virtually no signs of his original illness now. The signs that the movements of his mouth are completely side effects of the drugs that he was on for 20 years. Mr. Blount is quite rational. He understands what's going on. And if you're patient, he can carry on a very rational conversation with you.
Even when you remove the drug, it may still remain. It means you have caused a permanent disabling of the brain. In the late 50s, you get the first signs of it, people starting to worry about it. But it's not until the late 70s that psychiatrists start warning their patients about it, 20 years.
Le fabricant de la thorazine, Smith Kline French, avait de bonnes raisons de camoufler les mauvaises nouvelles. Rien que la première année, il avait fait un bénéfice de 3000% sur son investissement initial. Tout en cachant au public et à la presse les graves effets secondaires des psychotropes, d'éminents médecins et psychiatres se sont réunis à Porto Rico pour établir un plan à long terme sur la propagation des psychotropes. Voici ce que le docteur Nathan Kline a écrit dans son rapport final après la conférence.
The present breadth of drug use may be almost trivial when we compare it to the possible number of chemical substances that will be available for the control of selective aspects of man's life in the year 2000.
Le Dr. Kline était à la tête d'un mouvement qui visait à inonder le marché de nouveaux remèdes psychiatriques miracles, soutenu par une campagne publicitaire de centaines de millions de dollars. La psychiatrie était devenue une industrie de dealers. En 1970, l'Association américaine de psychiatrie était devenue financièrement si dépendante de l'industrie pharmaceutique que 30% de son budget annuel provenait d'annonces publicitaires pour des psychotropes dans ses revues officielles.
So we had money flowing to trade organizations, we had money flowing to the doctors, and to their journals. Well, we all know that that is going to influence how they think.
The majority of National Institute of Mental Health and National Institute of Health scientists are getting more money from drug companies on the side than their tax-based salary.
Avec tant d'argent à gagner, les psychiatres n'avaient besoin que d'une théorie scientifique pour justifier leurs gains. Leur solution? Un rapport officiel déclarant que tous les troubles mentaux provenaient d'un soi-disant déséquilibre chimique du cerveau, d'où la nécessité de psychotropes.
This chemical imbalance is one of the greatest fallacies ever foisted upon patients and the public. There is no chemical test to show an imbalance related to any psychiatric disease, whether it's depression, anxiety, what have you.
The chemical imbalance is for the benefit of the psychiatrist. It has to be there so the psychiatrist can treat it.
Mais les théories frauduleuses du déséquilibre chimique ne pouvaient cacher l'évidence des effets terrifiants des psychotropes comme l'akathisie.
Akathisia is like an extreme nervous, inner nervous agitation. People describe it as wanting to crawl out of their own skins. And this happens with great frequency, and it is absolutely, totally well understood to be associated with suicide and violence and homicide.
En 1991, après des années de rapports sur les effets secondaires, sur les cas de violence, d'automutilation et de mort, des experts de la santé, des législateurs et le public ont finalement forcé la FDA à exiger une enquête.
I know with absolute certainty that if Charles had any idea of the side effects of Prozac, he would never have taken it.
I had two sons, David Lee, age 8, Billy 16, wife 20 years old, gone. I'll tell you why. After being on Prozac for 21 days, my wife shot and killed both of these two boys right here. She turned the gun to herself and shot herself twice.
I took the 9mm automatic, sat down on the bed and put the gun to my head. And I blew a 4-inch hole out the back of my arm instead of my head. Thank God I was a lousy shot. Had someone looked further into Prozac, steps could have been taken to avoid it.
La commission d'enquête supposée être impartiale était formée par un groupe de psychiatres dont la majorité recevait un soutien financier des sociétés pharmaceutiques.
They basically couldn't find an expert, a doctor, a psychiatrist, at a leading medical school who basically in some way or another didn't have a consulting agreement, hadn't taken money from the pharmaceutical companies.
I do not find from the evidence today that there is credible evidence to support a conclusion that antidepressant drugs cause the emergence and or the intensification of suicidality and or other violent behaviors.
500 deaths, 33 murder cases, and over 20,000 adverse side effects. Would you like to tell me why this drug is still on the market?
Is there an alliance, an unholy alliance between psychiatric community, the pharmaceutical industry, and the FDA? And the answer is yes.
Cette alliance immorale est apparue au grand jour en 1997, lorsque les sociétés pharmaceutiques ont obtenu de la FDA le droit de faire leur publicité auprès du public. Avec les psychiatres vantant le caractère médical des psychotropes, leurs ventes ont augmenté de plus de 2,5 fois en moins de 3 ans. Quand le nombre des victimes de violences et de suicides atteignit un niveau effrayant, l'indignation du public finit par contraindre la FDA à émettre des mises en garde à propos des antidépresseurs. Mais entre-temps, 13 ans s'étaient écoulés, avec des milliards de dollars empochés et d'autres drogues miracles mises sur le marché. Aujourd'hui, plus de 8% de la population mondiale a pris des psychotropes, cautionnés par une pseudo-science et approuvés par des experts corrompus, rapportant par an près de 27 milliards de dollars. En trouvant le moyen de diagnostiquer des troubles chez tous afin de les droguer, les psychiatres poursuivaient leurs attaques contre nos libertés les plus fondamentales. Les psychiatres réclament le droit absolu de décider de ce qui convient le mieux aux soi-disant malades mentaux. Après tout, les malades mentaux sont fous et incapables de choisir leur propre traitement. Pour imposer leur pouvoir sur les autres et garantir que le taux d'occupation de leurs établissements est rentable, les psychiatres utilisent l'internement d'office.
When you go to a real doctor, say a family doctor or a cardiologist, a patient always has the right to refuse treatment. So there is no such thing as involuntary treatment when it comes to clinical medicine as practiced by real doctors. Psychiatrists, of course, believe that people can be treated against their will.
En 1956, le psychiatre Winfred Overholzer a présenté au Congrès américain un projet proposant d'amener l'internement d'office à un tout autre niveau. Ce projet, acheter un demi-million d'hectares de terres sauvages en Alaska, construire un immense hôpital psychiatrique et changer les lois sur l'internement de sorte que n'importe qui pourrait y être envoyé sur un signe de tête d'un psychiatre. Le projet de loi a été approuvé par la Chambre des représentants. Mais lorsque le public a eu vent de ce projet, qu'il a appelé « Sibérie des États-Unis », il était furieux. Ce projet a aussitôt été attaqué par le Sénat. Mais si l'échec du projet de loi Sibérie avait mis un frein au plan de grande envergure, l'internement d'office restait toujours la méthode la plus efficace et la plus rentable pour remplir les établissements psychiatriques.
Again, the person has committed no crime and has no trial and is sent directly to a mental hospital, which is really a prison.
How many people go to an insane asylum and say, please lock me up? Doctors don't lock up anybody. Psychiatrists lock you up.
Même les enfants peuvent être séparés de leurs parents avec peu de chances de recours.
They just invaded our home. They came in with officers. Our kids were scared. You know, they come in with pieces of paper and say, you're giving us your kids. And it's like, you know, how can they just come in and do that?
She said, you could be arrested for medical neglect. And I said, but how was that when, you know, this is my child? And I see that he doesn't need that much medication. Why would you threaten me with something like that?
At 10 p.m., two policemen and two social workers came to my house and took all four of my kids away.
Une fois internés dans les hôpitaux psychiatriques, les patients sont drogués et mis sous contention.
The more a person objects, the more this objection is construed as symptom of a mental illness.
At which point the person would be locked up in restraints. There would be the ankle, the knee, the waist, the head, the wrist, and the shoulder restraints. And if when that process was happening, if there was almost any resistance at all, the person then would be medicated to a point where they would almost be knocked out.
We had one case where they actually took a patient in a seclusion room and beat him up. Then they lied about it to the services that investigated. So it's a pretty wide range of abuse issues that we've encountered.
Le personnel psychiatrique incite les patients à être violents de façon à pouvoir facturer aux compagnies d'assurance jusqu'à 1 600 $ par jour pour chaque patient sous contention.
A patient would resist diagnosis, resist treatment, and also want to leave treatment while they were at the hospital. And invariably, every time, that person's situation would be exacerbated until they were put in constraints and medicated, at which point there would be documented reasons to keep that person in treatment.
Le contribuable porte le fardeau de ces traitements sous la forme d'une augmentation importante des primes d'assurance maladie. Pour les victimes, l'expérience est traumatisante, voire fatale.
16-year-old Rochelle Claiborne died in Laurel Ridge's care last August. The state report shows during the restraint, quote, Rochelle stated several times she could not breathe.
In almost all respects, the staff behaved appropriately, followed the standards.
Profitant de lois sur la contention peu restrictives ou vagues, les psychiatres et leur personnel ne sont presque jamais jugés responsables de coups et blessures et de meurtres.
He begged me to take him home, take him out of there, that they were treating him wrongly, and he didn't want to stay there. And I got a call that there had been an accident, that they held him down until he couldn't breathe anymore. I wish I would have listened to him, take him out of there before it had happened. And then I miss him every day. And I wish I could have him back, but I can't.
À ce jour, personne n'a été condamné pour le meurtre de cet enfant. Les personnes âgées sont les principales victimes d'abus psychiatriques. Le traitement des retraitées en milieu psychiatrique coûtant aux assurances privées et publiques plus de 29 milliards de dollars par an.
Unwarranted commitment has occurred that wouldn't have occurred if the people hadn't had insurance. The proof of that pudding is generally in how fast they get out once the insurance runs out.
Involuntary commitment is a form of psychiatric slavery, where persons are treated as if they're property and they are deprived of liberty and people are making money in the process.
As long as we have involuntary mental hospitalization, psychiatry is a prison work. It's a crime against humanity, it is not medicine.
Chaque minute de chaque jour, une personne est internée contre son gré dans un établissement psychiatrique. Et si vous pensez que c'est quelque chose qui ne peut pas vous arriver à vous ou à l'une de vos connaissances, réfléchissez-y à nouveau. Chaque 75 secondes, quelqu'un en Amérique a été interné contre son gré. Avec plus $1 billion alloués aux hôpitaux américains depuis 1965, les psychiatres se sont construits pour eux-mêmes une entreprise commerciale lucrative sous le couvert d'une interprétation douteuse de la loi. Mais trop souvent, les psychiatres commettent des crimes trop flagrants pour être ignorés.
The FBI has raided the headquarters of one of the nation's largest operators of psychiatric hospitals.
Hundreds complained of overbilling, misdiagnosed conditions, and insurance fraud.
Investigators say they found more than 5,000 similar cases in all 50 states.
Psychiatrists clearly are getting rich.
Psychiatrists traded drugs for sex, filed false insurance claims, and exploited patients sexually.
We have uncovered some of the most elaborate, aggressive, creative, deceptive, immoral, and illegal schemes being used to fill empty hospital beds with insured and paying patients.
Chaque psychiatre fait le serment d'adhérer à un code de conduite éthique. Considérer le bien-être de ses patients avant tout. Mais de toutes les disciplines médicales, la psychiatrie connaît le plus grand nombre d'escroqueries et d'abus.
Psychiatry is almost a license to print money. If a doctor were clever enough, and many of them are, there's no reason that they couldn't make at least $500,000 a year fraudulently and get away with it in psychiatry.
I don't purport to have deposed every psychiatrist in Las Vegas. I can tell you for a fact I haven't. Maybe I've deposed half. And by and large, they were a dishonest, deceitful, lying bunch of people.
Les méthodes de facturation trompeuses et criminelles des psychiatres sont si répandues que les enquêteurs d'assurance ont des expressions pour en parler, telles que le « hello à la va-vite » ou encore la poignée de main à 100 dollars.
$100 handshake is when usually a patient is institutionalized. Psychiatrist, psychologist will visit that person, shake hands with them, say hello, I'm doctor so-and-so, I'm taking care of your problem here, and then leaves.
They might have 10 or 20 patients there. They bill an hour for each one, and they might be in the hospital for a total of 30 minutes. So 20 patients, 20 hours, and they'd send the bills off to Medicaid.
We see that most of the victims of recovered memory therapy were women who had excellent health insurance, whether it was government insurance or private insurance, because many insurance policies wouldn't pay for this kind of long-term nonsense. So those people were targeted because of the nature of the insurance that they had.
Chaque année, la psychiatrie américaine escroque le gouvernement et les assurances privées de 40 milliards de dollars par tous les moyens possibles pour tromper le public.
There were some advertisements, very seductive advertisements, for people wanting to lose weight and were having problems losing weight. And they would be given, you know, all expenses paid to go to a particular spa. But when they got to this spa and went in and signed in, it wasn't a spa, it was a psychiatric center. And then they couldn't get out.
What instead they received is, they received massive doses of mind-altering drugs, and they were kept for a lengthy period of time, and their insurance carrier was billed tremendous amounts of money for something that was unnecessary.
Mais les psys mentent non seulement dans leur établissement, mais aussi au tribunal, disant n'importe quoi pour percevoir leur prime de témoin.
A psychiatric expert who will have one opinion in one scenario and a completely opposite opinion in another scenario based on which law firm or governmental agency is paying for his time.
The psychiatrist on one hand will tell the public that suicide can be prevented, but we'll go into court and tell a jury that suicide cannot be prevented. And then once you show his prior inconsistent statements, you also show that he is paid very well by pharmaceuticals, then the jury says, you know what, we're not so sure about you because you just lied to us.
À leur avidité, malhonnêteté et avarice s'ajoutent leurs délits sexuels. Si les psychiatres ne représentent que 6% du corps médical en Amérique, ils commettent le tiers des délits sexuels perpétrés par des médecins.
It has happened so often that by the mid-80s, the insurance companies who insure physicians across America started writing sexual claims out of the policies altogether. That's how common it was.
The system was so broken that more than 25,000 complaints had been registered, but nothing acted upon. When a psychiatrist has a patient, a female patient, and abuses them sexually, there's a very high probability they'll get away with it.
I've seen many cases where the mental health professional becomes very disturbed and is using very strange and odd treatments, and that can go on for many years with no one finding out about it because it's not very public. It's quite private. Things happen behind closed doors.
Malheureusement, leurs délits sexuels impliquent souvent des enfants. Par exemple, le docteur Mark Amberry était à première vue un habitant très respecté de son quartier. Mais cette image a volé en éclats lorsqu'il a été arrêté pour attentat à la pudeur sur des enfants. Des quantités incroyables de matériel pornographique avec des enfants ont été trouvées chez lui. Et l'enquête qui a suivi a révélé ses abus sexuels sur d'anciens patients. Des garçons de 7 à 17 ans qu'il photographiait et sodomisait. Cela a constitué ce que l'État a appelé les 50 ans d'aventure sexuelle effrénée et cachée de Berry avec des enfants. Il ne s'agit pas d'un cas isolé. Ce trait soigneusement dissimulé se retrouve typiquement chez les membres de cette profession. Dans chaque ville, chaque région, chaque pays, vous trouverez des psychiatres qui commettent des viols, abus sexuels, meurtres et escroqueries. Et comme vous allez le voir, toute la crédibilité de la psychiatrie repose sur la plus grande escroquerie de toutes.
I was diagnosed with a chemical imbalance, manic depression.
They diagnosed me with having ADD.
He told me I had conduct disorder.
ADHD.
Mild depression.
Major depression.
Manic depressive.
Borderline personality disorder.
Compulsive disorder.
Anxiety. Depression and schizophrenia.
Depression. ADHD.
Sleep disorder. Identity problem disorder.
There's no such thing as mental disorder. A mental disorder is whatever someone says it is, and if the person saying this is a mental disorder has enough power and influence, then people believe, oh, that's a mental disorder.
Mais l'autorité ou l'influence ne vont pas sans crédibilité. Aussi, la psychiatrie fabrique sa propre crédibilité.
It's based on a grab bag of checklists for disorders that are published in a book called the DSM, which is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. There are no statistics in this book, by the way. That just makes it sound more scientific.
They create this cluster of disease, and they get together and they vote. Is this a disease? All in favor say aye.
It's marketed as a scientifically based document. Now, the American Psychiatric Association, which publishes the DSM, do a lot of work to create an aura of scientific precision around the DSM, but it's not scientifically based.
Depuis la première édition du manuel diagnostique et statistique, DSM, le nombre de troubles mentaux votés et ajoutés à ce manuel psychiatrique est monté à 374. Et chaque fois que les psychiatres inventent un nouveau trouble mental, ils trouvent un autre moyen de tromper le public.
If you have 27 ways to bill in the DSM, that's 27 ways to bill. If you have 300, that's 300 ways to bill. So you can pretty much find anyone walking on the street that could fit into a DSM somehow.
When you build insurance companies, you can't say the word. You've got to send in a number. And they have numbers for the most ridiculous things. You know, like arguing with your mother or peeing in the bed.
Adolescent rebellion disorder is an official psychiatric diagnosis. Arithmetic learning disorder is an official psychiatric diagnosis. General anxiety disorder is a recent diagnosis.
For each one, there is a five-digit code with a decimal point. Now, the implication of that is if I have illness 403.16, that's different in some important and scientifically proven way from someone who has 403.17. And nothing could be further from the truth.
Aussi incroyable que cela soit, si les psychiatres présentent le DSM comme un ouvrage scientifique, ils admettent ouvertement qu'il n'a aucun fondement scientifique.
We have no diagnostic reliable markers for almost any illness there is in the DSM.
What we're testing for in psychiatry, it's hard to say because there's nothing specifically.
But as far as a test that's clinically useful, basically we're not there yet.
We don't have any laboratory tests that we can use to determine whether somebody does or doesn't have a mental illness.
There are no good biological tests for detecting mental illness.
There is no test, there's no biopsy you can do.
There is no chemical test right now.
There are no specific tests to confirm the diagnosis or show the improvement, like any blood tests or any x-rays or anything like that.
Oh, in my practice, I don't do any tests. I just speak with people and listen to them, and then I make a decision in what kind of illness.
Ces diagnostics sont complètement différents d'un psychiatre à l'autre. Une personne équipée d'une caméra cachée a consulté différents psychiatres en se plaignant des mêmes symptômes.
I'm extremely unorganized and I didn't used to be. It's caused problems in the family, it's caused problems getting, I'm self-employed.
You've got ADD, ADHD, and you're depressed, and your depression is bipolar depressed.
If you have a brain chemistry disorder, it's probably genetic.
You have a lot of the symptoms of depression.
So it seems like it is a mixed picture. What that means is like we got some depressive symptoms and some, high symptoms.
If you're bipolar, I'll need to give you a mood stabilizer. Mm-hmm. We don't know, I kind of doubt it.
It's considered low-grade bipolar.
You are more of the ADD than ADHD.
And as far as medications for depression, because I would recommend that you start a medication, which are Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil, Celexa.
Usually, Procalin XR is pretty good.
I'll give you some Lexapro in the morning and some Prazodone at night.
Lamictal is a better medication for that. It works on your depression also.
But the treatment for any bipolar cycling is the same. Lithium.
Remeron is another one.
Prazodone.
Segredol.
Lepagliflozin.
Wellbutrin.
Lexapro.
Lamictal.
Equatroid.
Depakote.
Lithium.
Ambien.
You may need an antidepressant also with your Lamictal.
We don't know if I give you a medication, if it is going to work or not.
To a certain degree, it's trial and error.
You never know if it's the right drug.
How many people have I cured? Well, there are no real cures right now in psychiatry.
I have cured none of my patients.
We're always challenged by our lack of knowledge.
I mean, in fact, we don't know what the causes of mental illness are.
Most mental illnesses, we do not know the cause.
And of course, it would be nice to know exact reasons of disorders, but maybe in the future.
I'm the director of research at the American Psychiatric Association. We don't know the etiology of really any of the mental disorders at the present time.
DSM-5 is coming out. It's grown to 10 times its original size, and it labels everybody. I could find 5 diagnoses that would fit you or anybody else.
Comparez cela aux méthodes de recherche de la pathologie, une vraie science qui découvre de vraies maladies en utilisant un grand nombre de tests précis pour les diagnostiquer.
We do millions of laboratory tests as well as the structural examination and the microscopic examination. It's a whole series of applied scientific procedures. In the case of psychiatry, there isn't any laboratory tool that can precisely identify a psychiatric disease and allow it to be classified.
It's not as if there's some study of tissue or some study of the body or some study of matter. These are all categories which are made up. They're simply made up. They don't exist in nature. They're decided upon by psychiatrists and voted on.
Les psychiatres ne sont pas les seuls à tirer profit du DSM. Chaque diagnostic psychiatrique s'accompagne d'un psychotrope.
The pharmaceutical corporations now contribute enormous sums of money for the education of psychiatric residents and for the support of research by their professors, so that psychiatry today has become very, in America, has become very largely the learning of which drug to use with which disease or disorder.
We need to make sure that we understand the very close interactions among the American Psychiatric Association with its DSM, the pharmaceutical companies, who love the fact that every time there's a new edition of the DSM, there are dozens more categories in there. And so more conditions for the drug companies to say, oh, we've got a pill for that.
En 2006, une étude a rapporté que 56% des psychiatres qui décidaient des troubles à ajouter à la prochaine édition du DSM avaient des intérêts financiers en commun avec au moins une société pharmaceutique. Aujourd'hui, nous en voyons les conséquences. Une avalanche de psychotropes destinés à des troubles inventés et cautionnés par un diagnostic arbitraire figurant dans le DSM.
The fact that it is couched in the language of science, without, again, without necessarily having any of the scientific data or underpinnings to justify it, is as threatening as anything we've seen today.
Le dernier stratagème très onéreux de la psychiatrie pour tromper le public en imitant l'autorité médicale légitime, les scanographies du cerveau.
We can scan all the brains we want to. The fact that we see changes in different people's brains, changes in functioning, doesn't mean that we've discovered anything that has its origin in the brain. It just means that we're seeing changes, but it doesn't mean that there's something wrong with the brain.
Les psychiatres et les psychologues se servent du DSM pour coller une étiquette de malade mental sur 450 millions de personnes dans le monde, ce qui équivaut à la totalité de la population de la France, de l'Italie, de l'Allemagne, du Canada, de l'Australie, du Royaume-Uni et de la Russie combinées. Cependant, la vente de psychotropes sur ordonnance a atteint au niveau mondial le chiffre de 27 milliards de dollars par an en subventions gouvernementales et rapporte à la psychiatrie 440 milliards de dollars par an. La plupart de cet argent provient de diagnostics et de psychotropes donnés à ceux qui nous font le plus confiance et qui sont les plus vulnérables.
We have swallowed all manner of poisonous certainties fed us by our parents and school teachers. If the race is to be freed from its crippling burden of good and evil, it must be psychiatrists who take the original responsibility.
La déclaration de Brock Chisholm caractérisait l'assaut psychiatrique dirigé vers notre système scolaire.
They actually said that the purpose was social control. Not to pass on knowledge, not to give him something so that he can go into the world of work.
En 1950, des psychiatres et psychologues du monde entier se sont réunis à la Maison Blanche pour proposer une réorientation totale du système scolaire public.
The White House Conference on Mental Health in the 1950s was a landmark that served to bolster the idea that schools would serve their communities better in the, as mental health clinics than they would as institutions of learning.
In the early 60s, the world of psychiatry started to really go places in this country, little by little. It came into our schools, our educational system.
Et en 1965, une nouvelle législation a confirmé ce fait. Les psychiatres avaient obtenu le feu vert pour étiqueter et droguer en masse les enfants dans les écoles.
A child is labeled ADD or ADHD the minute he can't sit still for a 10-15 minute period of time, or he talks constantly or ignores the teacher completely. That will get him and earn him in ADD or ADHD label.
L'étiquetage du trouble de l'hyperactivité avec déficit de l'attention, THADA, battait son plein en 1987. En l'espace d'un an, 500 000 enfants américains furent diagnostiqués THADA. En 1994, ce nombre avait atteint 4 400 000. En réponse à l'inquiétude du public face à cette épidémie apparente de maladie mentale, les Instituts nationaux de la santé, financés par le gouvernement américain, ont réuni un groupe de médecins et psychiatres éminents pour expliquer aux parents et éducateurs ce qu'était le THADA.
I would like any member of the panel to describe a typical ADHD in terms of symptomatology. Mark, would you like to? Since you see them in your practice.
I think the panel has been frank, and you know, the difficulties here are immense in terms it is hard. It's very hard to know how to answer this question. They cannot, you know, even when. They are as if driven by a motive. There are some good clinical descriptions. And I think, you know, I think the part of the problem is the profession keeps changing the diagnosis.
At this time, we do not have a diagnostic test for ADHD. Therefore, the validity of the disorder continues to be a problem.
Mais cet aveu choquant n'a pas arrêté les psychiatres des écoles. 2 ans plus tard, le nombre de cas de THADA diagnostiqués chez les étudiants américains se montait à 6 millions. Aujourd'hui, 20 millions d'enfants dans le monde sont étiquetés d'un trouble quelconque de l'apprentissage. Un diagnostic souvent établi en quelques minutes.
We would sit behind a two-way mirror along with the parents. We would then look at the child. We would like do small manipulative activities with them to see where their deficit was. It was wrong what we were doing. We were looking at a 5-minute glimpse of this child's life and saying, okay, here you go. Here's a little pill, take it, you'll be fine.
Ces petites pilules, comme la Ritaline, l'Adderall et le Concerta, sont classées par l'Agence américaine de lutte contre la drogue comme des substances aussi addictives que la cocaïne, l'héroïne et la méthamphétamine.
When I was on the Ritalin, it made me just feel like totally different, like I wasn't even who I was.
I was, you know, flipping out, twitching, you know, going crazy.
I felt like I was out of it all the time, like I wasn't there. I wasn't human.
You're just a zombie, pretty much. You do what you can just to get by and just don't do anything extra.
My mother never teased me, but she thought I really had ADHD and I was wrong, and I had something wrong with me. So I thought she'd feel bad and feel sorry for me if I died. But then again, I thought that she would miss me a lot, and I also love her a little more than I wanted to kill myself. And so I stopped when I realized that.
L'abondance de prescriptions de psychotropes rapporte aussi à certains enfants qui vendent leurs pilules aux camarades de classe.
It's called kitty cocaine. They take the Ritalin and they just repackage it and they sell it on campus to the kids because it's like speed.
I figured like if I was going to do drugs, I might as well make it worth it. And I ended up doing street drugs, and then ended up getting into it really bad.
We're looking at marijuana and other things as being gateway drugs, and actually the so-called medications are a greater gateway drug.
The Ritalin drugs are backfiring big time, because if the child is already disruptive and he takes cocaine, he's going to be a lot more disruptive after he's taken it. It is not going to calm him down.
Boom, she got on the drugs and her personality changed, her behaviors changed, they became erratic and dark and violent, and it was just a nightmare.
He kept having adverse reactions, becoming very, very angry. He could not control his behavior, he couldn't control his temper.
He was on 5 different psych meds, Prozac and lithium, and he was 7 years old. And he was unable to function. He would have rages and then crying and all kinds of just violent rages, grabbing knives and all of this.
The list includes 15-year-old Kip Kinkle withdrawing from Prozac when he shot 22 classmates, killing 2, after murdering his mother and stepfather at his home in Springfield, Oregon. 18-year-old Jason Hoffman on Effexor and Celexa, and he opened fire at his California high school, wounding 5. 15-year-old Sean Cooper on a mix of antidepressants when he shot students in Idaho. And 17-year-old Eric Harris on Luvox when he and partner Dylan Klebold killed 12 classmates and a teacher in the bloodiest school massacre yet, Columbine.
Tout cela obscurcit la raison même pour laquelle les enfants vont à l'école, acquérir une éducation. Depuis 1970, les États-Unis ont chuté de la 9e à la 28e place dans le classement académique mondial. Alors que durant cette même période, le nombre d'écoliers américains étiquetés de troubles de l'apprentissage est monté en flèche. Et la vente de psychotropes pour traiter le THADA a été multipliée par 32.
Children don't ask for psychiatric drugs. Children don't ask to be diagnosed. They don't want to be called crazy. So you ask to ask the classic Roman question, legal question, cui bono, who benefits? The people who make the diagnosis.
Psychiatry should actually go into government, that politicians should listen to psychiatrists. Psychiatrists should be in every parliament and should direct and monitor political activities.
En un peu plus d'un siècle, la psychiatrie a infiltré la société à l'échelle mondiale. Et ce n'est pas par accident.
People aren't aware that in 1940, a prominent British psychiatrist, Colonel J.R. Rees, addressed the National Council on Mental Hygiene and set the agenda for psychiatry for the next 60 years. Since then, psychiatrists have been given authority in nearly every sector of our society, with tragic results.
We must aim to make it permeate every educational activity in our national life. Public life, politics, and industry should all of them be within our sphere of influence. We have made a useful attack upon a number of professions. The two easiest of them, naturally, are the teaching profession and the church. The most difficult are law and medicine.
Plus tard, un collègue de Rees, le psychiatre Brock Chisholm, cofondateur de la Fédération mondiale de la santé mentale, élargit les plans de la psychiatrie.
To achieve world government, it is necessary to remove from the minds of men their individualism, loyalty to family traditions, national patriotism and religious dogmas.
Pour mettre leur plan à exécution, les psychiatres américains ont convaincu le Congrès que la maladie mentale était une menace nationale qu'eux seuls, moyennant des fonds plus importants, pouvaient résoudre. Donc, le gouvernement a accordé à la recherche psychiatrique des fonds énormes, passant de 1 million de dollars par an en 1946 à 1,4 milliard de dollars aujourd'hui, une augmentation de plus de 139 000%. À mesure que l'influence de la psychiatrie se répandait en Amérique, elle le faisait aussi dans le monde entier. Derrière chaque crise mondiale, on trouve la psychiatrie à l'œuvre. Par exemple, le psychiatre serbe Jovan Raskovic, qui a demandé la purification ethnique des Croates et des musulmans car il croyait fermement à leur infériorité raciale. Résultat, en Bosnie dans les années 90, un collègue de Raskovic, le psychiatre Radovan Karadzic et le premier ministre Slobodan Milosevic ont établi des camps de concentration dans les Balkans, où à nouveau, un grand nombre d'innocents ont été torturés, violés et assassinés. Un psychiatre militaire a expliqué comment cela avait été accompli.
C'est très difficile tuer millions de personnes. C'est très difficile, techniquement difficile. Les Allemands étaient bons techniciens et ils ne pouvaient pas, ils pouvaient seulement 6 millions de Juifs exterminés. Ils massacrent, par exemple, 100 ou 200 de personnes ou violent 100 femmes et sans jeunes filles pour que les autres soient effrayés et échappent. Alors vous avez le terrain pur.
Avec les techniques de conditionnement pavloviennes du siècle dernier et celles du contrôle mental moderne, psychiatres et psychologues peuvent transformer hommes et enfants en assassins de masse.
You could train them to use firearms indiscriminately. You could train them to shoot people with very little feeling or thought. You could train them to use abusive and brutalizing procedures in order to obtain information with no hesitancy, with no concern.
Voilà comment produire des terroristes. À la suite du 11 septembre, Osama Ben Laden était considéré comme le cerveau derrière les attaques. Mais le véritable cerveau et commandant d'Al-Qaïda est Ayman al-Zawahiri, étudiant de psychologie et de pharmacologie à l'université du Caire et auteur du manuel de formation d'Al-Qaïda sur l'utilisation de la psychiatrie coercitive. Pour orchestrer les bombardements terroristes à Madrid, Abu Hafiza, un autre membre d'Al-Qaïda, s'est appuyé sur les mêmes techniques de manipulation mentale.
You can implant memories. Memories are potent sources of motivated behavior. If you implant enough memories of specific kinds, you can shape and change the nature of human thinking and feelings.
And it was thought to be a kind of ultimate weapon, because what greater weapon could there be than control of the human mind?
You can control minds and you can move people around, particularly when you control their lives. It's easier to control their minds.
When we look at psychiatry and psychology, social control is the primary agenda.
Actuellement, ce programme est exécuté dans le monde entier par le biais de campagnes d'évaluation de la santé mentale, livrées au public sous des noms aussi inoffensifs que Teen Screen.
The national government is actually encouraging it and wanting to test every single kid in our public school system.
All children are put under this kind of a test for psychiatric evaluation, a 10-minute test that tells them absolutely nothing.
I predict that upwards of 90% of all the people screened will be diagnosed as having a psychiatric disorder, which means that we'll have an entire generation that will be a perfect profit center.
L'homme derrière le programme de tests pour les jeunes est le psychiatre David Schaffer, conseiller au département de la défense américaine.
They're not just screening children to have complete control of the 52 million children in school. They're screening now, and that bill, they will screen their parents, and they will screen all adults in America.
The idea of mass screening for mental illness in the American population, run by a government initiative, is one of the scariest ideas I ever heard of.
Psychiatry is politics, has always been politics. It is politics pure and simple, because psychiatry was always the application of force against people who don't want to be forced.
It's a sad thing, and parents better wake up. Society better wake up, because we're in serious trouble if they don't.
Le plan d'ensemble de la psychiatrie pour infiltrer tous les secteurs de la société se réalise. Nous n'avons pas d'épidémie de maladie mentale. Nous avons une épidémie de psychiatrie. Quelque chose peut et doit être fait à ce sujet. Fondée en 1969 par l'Église de Scientologie, la Commission des citoyens pour les droits de l'homme enquête et expose les abus psychiatriques sur les droits de l'homme. À partir de son siège international à Los Angeles, Californie, CCDH se documente sur les méthodes d'intrusion et de destruction de la psychiatrie et les publie dans des brochures en 15 langues. Plus de 8 millions ont été distribués au personnel médical, à des officiels, des éducateurs et chefs d'entreprise du monde entier. Au siège se trouve également une exposition de renommée mondiale, Psychiatrie, la vérité sur ses abus. Centrée autour de 14 films documentaires, cette exposition de dernier cri présente l'histoire de la psychiatrie. Depuis ses origines où les malades mentaux étaient mis en cage comme des animaux, jusqu'au dopage actuel de la société pour guérir des troubles mentaux inventés. L'exposition itinérante se rend dans des centaines de villes sur 5 continents pour que des centaines de milliers de personnes découvrent l'horrible vérité qu'est la psychiatrie. Ce mouvement mondial des droits de l'homme commença il y a plus de 30 ans, lors d'une lutte pour rendre la liberté à un individu. Victor Giori, interné de force dans un hôpital psychiatrique de Pennsylvanie.
He was interviewed by a psychiatrist who said, I can't understand a word this man is saying. He's incoherent. Obviously, a paranoid schizophrenic. Commit him, which they did. Now, he wasn't babbling incoherently. He was speaking Hungarian. We filed a lawsuit against the hospital. In the middle of the case, the doctor, who was the head of the hospital, stands up and he says, we want nothing more to do with Victor Giori.
La libération de Victor Giori a été la première parmi les milliers de cas que la CCDH a aidé dans le monde.
CCHR challenged involuntary commitment laws throughout the United States and internationally, and what we found was that people were being incarcerated without any legal rights.
They had no right to an attorney. They could be drugged, shot, lobotomized without their consent.
Exemple, Australie 1977, où la CCDH a dénoncé le traitement psychiatrique par sommeil profond.
Patients were being knocked unconscious with a cocktail of barbiturates and other psychiatric drugs, and they were being subjected to electroshock treatment daily, sometimes twice daily, without their knowledge. Deep sleep treatment had led to 48 deaths.
La CCDH a enquêté, a divulgué ces faits et a lutté pendant plus d'une décennie pour le faire interdire. En Afrique du Sud, CCDH a dénoncé les camps psychiatriques où on enfermait, brutalisait et exploitait les malades mentaux comme des esclaves. En Italie, la CCDH s'est associée à des législateurs et aux médias, faisant des descentes dans des hôpitaux psychiatriques où régnait un climat barbare et la CCDH les a fait fermer. Au Japon, CCDH a dénoncé les crimes financiers des psychiatres et des hôpitaux qui escroquaient le gouvernement et le contribuable. Les coupables ont été poursuivis et les hôpitaux ont été fermés. Et aux États-Unis, la CCDH a révélé une fraude $1 milliard dans la plus grande chaîne d'hôpitaux psychiatriques du pays. 600 agents fédéraux ont mené des incursions dans 20 États. Résultat, des douzaines de poursuites, des millions à verser et la chaîne d'hôpitaux corrompus a été mise en faillite et fermée définitivement. Derrière chaque mise en garde que vous voyez aujourd'hui au sujet des psychotropes se trouve la CCDH.
CCHR has documented the side effects of these drugs, has taken evidence to the FDA, has gone to Congress, has obtained congressional hearings.
It took 13 years before the FDA finally admitted that those drugs can cause suicide and issued black box warnings. We got 9 state laws passed. Following that, it was the introduction of the Child Medication Safety Act in 2004.
Rien que depuis 3 ans, il y a eu plus de 50 mises en garde auprès des agences internationales de contrôle de médicaments dénonçant les dangers des psychotropes.
History has told us every workable method that could be used to help people who are seriously disturbed, who do need some sort of treatment, has been suppressed and smashed by the vested interests of psychiatry and the pharmaceutical industry.
The public's largely been getting their information from the industry that benefits on putting them on psychiatric drugs. It's an advertising campaign. It's not science, it's marketing.
CCHR is causing things to change by being champions for a growing number of well-intentioned people who are risking their professional careers to speak up against the abuses of psychiatry.
Having that support from a group like this has made a tremendous difference in what I feel personally that I've been able to accomplish.
So I think of CCHR as fellow soldiers.
I'm unaware of any other organization that does the kind of work that CCHR does, particularly on the scope and the level that they do.
CCHR has been very effective at moving the ball down the field. One at a time, one state at a time, one legislator at a time.
CCHR has had the resources to be able to teach and have legislators become more aware of what the problem with the psychotropic drugs are.
CCHR has researched the issue. When you need the facts, you go to CCHR.
Aujourd'hui, la CCDH a plus de 300 groupes dans de nombreux pays dans le monde. Chaque fois que les psychiatres violent les droits de l'homme, la CCDH se fait entendre partout. Des États-Unis au Japon, du Canada au Royaume-Uni, Des membres éminents de la CCDH organisent des marches pour protéger le monde des mauvais traitements psychiatriques.
It's essential that CCHR does their job and gets the support to do their job. Because the extent to which they do, the whole vehicle that's out of control about psychiatry gets to be contained and gets to be eliminated. It scares me to think if this doesn't happen. I've seen up close what it's like, and it scares the daylights out of me.
You have 100,000 people electroshocked every year. You have 17 million children worldwide taking mind-altering drugs. You have people being involuntarily committed every 75 seconds, and it's all under the guise of mental health.
The only way that you are going to get humane treatment into the mental health system is to take psychiatry and the vested interests out of the picture. And only then will you see people truly obtaining mental health.
You have two choices. Either you pretend you knew nothing about it, or you do something about it. With knowledge comes responsibility. That's why we're here. That's why people are joining forces with CCHR.
Des milliers de personnes de toutes croyances et de tous milieux se joignent à nous. La CCDH mène des enquêtes et dénonce les violations psychiatriques des droits de l'homme. Elle persistera jusqu'à ce que la brutalité de la psychiatrie et ses abus cessent et que les droits de l'homme et sa dignité soient rendus à tous. Nous avons besoin de votre aide. Joignez-vous à nous dans la lutte.